Jennifer, when people are hearing about weight loss surgeries, sometimes that also is interchangeably used with bariatric surgery. What is it that they're actually hearing about? What are these surgeries? Can you give kind of just a quick summary of what a person might expect to hear more about if they wanted to learn about it?
Yeah. Well, we call them, you know, metabolic surgery, bariatric surgery, weight loss surgery. I tend to be in favor of the metabolic surgery because this kind of surgery, yes, it gets the weight down, which is fantastic. But I would argue that the bigger benefit is what you mentioned, part of what you mentioned, in that it not just gets the weight down, but it helps them keep it down. But then also it helps reduce those often weight-related medical conditions. So that might be diabetes, might be blood pressure problems, might be sleep apnea and similar things. And so it really outdoes any, you know, non-surgical therapies, pharmacotherapies, in terms of its effectiveness in either reducing or in some cases resolving some of those medical issues.
Sure.
And like I said, not just get the weight down, but then keeps it down. So it really is a metabolic, metabolic change that the surgery is producing. There are two, generally speaking, main surgeries that are done. Nationally speaking, they kind of go back and forth, which one is the most popular, but there is the sleeve gastrectomy, which is where the surgeons will, and I would mention, most of the surgeries are done laparoscopically, so they just do smaller incisions. And they use their instruments to do the actual procedure. But the sleeve gastrectomy is one of the surgeries. And this surgery, they take a portion of the stomach out. Food still moves through the same exact way as it had before, but a small portion of that is out. In the gastric bypass surgery, so the other more common surgery, they are essentially making a portion of the stomach smaller, and then you're bypassing a small portion of the intestinal tract. So you're losing weight, but you're also, it's called a restrictive and a malabsorption procedure. And so in both of those surgeries, not only anatomically, so the structure of how our food kind of travels and gets absorbed through our body is different, but it actually changes a lot of the hormones. Mm-hmm. We had talked in similar segments about our hunger and fullness hormones, leptin and ghrelin. It changes some of that. It changes some of our insulin resistance. So we have a lot of patients that struggle with insulin resistance for sure. And that's part of the way it helps with diabetes. We have patients, and this is an amazing thing, on multiple medications, including insulin, go home without any insulin. It's exceedingly, I keep saying, rewarding, but this, you know, what we do is just so rewarding.
Yes.
But to see a patient who has struggled for so long not have to do, their insulin and not have to take some of their medications is really just, to be along with them with that whole process is really just an amazing thing. So, you know, we think about it for weight, and certainly, absolutely, it gets the weight down, but you know, the bigger sort of longevity, bigger picture of it is it really does change the trajectory of their health.
Yeah.
They're not needing to take as many medications. They feel better, their joints feel better. And when we talk about sleep, many times we find sleep apnea because that's part of our screening process.
Sure.
When we're, evaluating somebody to see if they're the right candidate for surgery. And that's part of our discussion is that, well, you know, to treat it if it's there, but also on the other end of things, if it is there, that oftentimes the sleep apnea gets better and sometimes even goes away, which is again an amazing thing to watch.
Yeah. So one of the things I think is fascinating when you talk about the relationship specifically of sleep apnea with bariatric surgeries is that many times there's a perception that this is an optional thing to look at. And or that it's you're only screening me because I'm overweight. And so in fact, one of the things that is really important in regards to this journey is that the reason that obstructive sleep apnea is a part of an evaluation for bariatric surgery is it actually has been shown that when you identify and optimally treat sleep apnea, your outcomes related to surgery are better than those who don't have it. And so again, this is one of those points that I'm hoping you take as a drive home of that sleep isn't optional. Treating sleep apnea isn't optional. Treating any sleep disorder isn't optional. This is the tool that you have in control in your own hands to be able to optimize your own wellness journey. That's right. Better nights are going to lead to your better health.